Hello, yes. I am VSSP Rajshekar, Assistant Professor of Mathematics, Government Degree College for Women, Nalgonda. In today's video, I will discuss about rank of a matrix. So this is our class map of this video. Let us first quickly recap the concepts of null space, column space, and row space of a matrix. And we find basis for null space, column space, and row space of a matrix. Later, we define rank of a matrix. And we prove a theorem on rank of a matrix. Later, we solve some of the problems using rank theorem. So this is the today's class map. Let us first recap the definition of the null space. The null space of an m by n matrix A written as null A. And that is the set of all solutions of the homogeneous equation Ax is equal to. The system of homogeneous equations is converted into a matrix form that will be in Ax is equal to O, where O is the zero vector. Then null A will give you solutions for that system. That is, null A is the set of X such that X belongs to Rn and Ax is equal to O. So it is a set of all vectors in Rn which will give you null matrix when multiplied, left multiplied with A, the coefficient matrix of the given homogeneous equations. So null A is a set of all X belongs to Rn that are mapped onto the zero vector of Rn. And we have already seen that null space of an m by n matrix A is a subspace of Rn, and column space is the set of all linear combination of columns of matrix A, and it is denoted by column space A. We use this symbol. If A is equal to matrix of A1, A2 and so on An, where A1, A2 and so on An are the columns of the matrix, then column space A is the spanning set of these column vectors A1, A2 and so on A. And in the last video, we have in detail discussed the properties of null space A and column space A. And we define row space A, and we do some of the examples on. We did some of the examples on row space there. And let us recall the definition of row space again. If A is an m by n matrix, each row of A has n entries. So an m by n matrix has m rows and n columns. So you will find m rows. Each of the row will contain n entries. So each row is a vector in R. The set of linear combination of row vectors is called the row space of A and is denoted by row A. So we call it as row space A. We write the first three letters of the row A, we call it as row space. Each row has n entries, so row space A is a subspace of Rn. We have already seen that null space A is also subspace of Rn, and column space of A is subspace of Rm. Since each entry in a column space, column vector has m entries. since there are m rows. But the each vector in row space will have n entries, so row space A is a subspace of R. Since the rows of A are identified with the columns of A transpose, that is, if you transpose A, you will get A transpose. The columns will become rows, rows will become columns. So row space of the matrix A is nothing but column space of A transpose. So if necessary, we can write column space of A transpose in place of row space A and vice versa. And we have proved this statement also in the previous class. If two matrices A and B are row equivalent, then their row spaces are the same. If B is in echelon form, the non-zero rows of B form a basis for the row space A as well as for that of B. So while performing elementary row operations, we get linear combination of rows and nothing else. So any linear combination of rows of A can be obtained by any linear combination of rows of B, where B is the row equivalent to A. So both are same. The space generated by both the rows in A and rows in B are same when all are taken. And zero rows produce nothing, so we can omit zero rows. So non-zero rows of B can form a basis for A also. Whereas both the row vectors can span the entire set, of course. But for a linearly independent set, to have a linearly independent set, we need to omit zero rows. Both can span, but to have the property of linearly independence, we need to eliminate the linearly independent vectors. So we are converting the matrix A into echelon form. So the non-zero rows in the matrix B, which is the echelon form of A, will form a basis for A as well as B. This is also we have proved in the previous video. So in today's class, let us solve a problem. Let us find the basis for row space, column space, and null space for the given matrix. Here A is given minus 2, minus 5, 8, 0, minus 17, 1, 3, minus 5, 1, 5, 3, 11, minus 19, 7, 1, 1, 7, minus 13, 5, minus 3. So it has 4 rows and 5 columns. So it is a 4 by 5 matrix. So we need to find column space, row space, and null space. So finding column space A and row space A is simple than finding the basis for null space A. So to find row space A and column space A, we need to convert A into echelon form. Once we convert A into echelon form, then we can identify pivot positions, pivot columns, and non-zero rows. So then we can simply form the basis for row space A and column space A. So A is equal to, now that A is converted into echelon form like this by performing elementary row operations. We have seen several problems, such problems. So I directly convert that into echelon form by using my software, which I have shown to you in the previous videos. So this is P. So now it is in echelon form. Since all the entries below this leading entry are zero, and next leading entry is right to the previous leading entry, and it is below it. So all the entries below one are below the leading entry are zeros, and this is my third pivot position. So we have three pivot positions. So these three are pivot columns. 1, 2, 4 are pivot columns. So clearly this is in echelon form. Non-zero rows of B form a basis for the row space of A. So we have four rows here. Since it is a 4 by 5 matrix. Out of the four rows, the fourth row is containing all zeros. So this is zero row. So remaining three are non-zero rows. These three rows, R1, R2, R3, you can call them. These three rows form a basis for the matrix A. Here we can observe that there are four rows here in A. These four rows can span row space of A. These four rows can span row space of A. So the space spanned by these four rows is equivalent to space spanned by these four rows or three rows, since the contribution from the fourth row is nothing, since it is a zero vector. So while we are talking about spanning, both the row vectors of A and row vectors of B are same while we are talking about spanning. So the set generated by all possible linear combination of these four rows is equivalent to set generated by linear combination of these three or four rows. But to form a basis, that set must be linearly independent. But these four rows are not linearly independent since there is a zero vector. But the first three rows are clearly linearly independent, since first one is non-zero and second row here we can come in the reverse direction. R3 is not a zero row and R3 cannot be and R2 cannot be, is not a linear combination of R2. Similarly, R1 is not a linear combination of R2 and R3. So clearly we can say that these three are R1, R2, R3. These three are linearly independent. So these three row vectors form a basis for row space here. So thus the basis for row space A is equal to the three non-zero rows of B. This set not only form a basis for B, this also form a basis for A also. This result was proved in the previous class, of course. So the row vectors, row space of A is equal to set of 1, 3, minus 5, 1, 5, and 0, 1, minus 2, 2, minus 7. And the third vector is 0, 0, 0, minus 4, 20. We can also write these vectors in as a column vectors also, but for convenience, as there are more entries in these vectors, these are written in the form of an n-tuple. But this set is equivalent to set of a column vector 1, 3, 5, 1, 3, minus 5, 1, 5. Both are same. Only for convenience, we have written in this form. That's it. So this is the basis for row space A. Now let us find the basis for column space A. So we have seen that our given matrix A is equivalent to this matrix, row equivalent to this matrix B, which is in echelon form. So here we can observe that 1, first this is a pivot position, and this is a pivot position, and this is a pivot position. So there are three pivot positions. So the columns which contain pivot positions are called pivot columns. So 1, 2, and 4 are the pivot columns. So B has 1, 2, 4 as pivot columns. So since it is in echelon form and row equivalent to A, the columns 1, 2, 4 of A, first column of A and second column of A and fourth column of A, form a basis for A. Form a basis for column space A. So basis for column space A is equal to first column of A, that is minus 2, 1, 3, 1, and second column of A, minus 5, 3, 11, 7, and fourth column of A, that is 0, 1, 7, 5. So this is the basis for column space A. Here we need to observe that in a row space, while we are calculating the basis for row space of A, we are taking the vectors of B. Vectors of B, non-zero rows of B, are forming the basis of B as well as basis for A. But in column space of A, we are not considering these vectors of B. We are taking corresponding columns of pivot columns of A. So since here 1, 2, 4 are pivot columns, these 1, 2, 4 pivot columns cannot form a basis for column space A. Since you will not get a real number in the fourth column, fourth row. Since these are all zeros, these zeros cannot form any number. So here we need to be cautious in this point that we need to take the corresponding column vectors of A only while considering the column space of A. We consider the basis for column space of A. When we are talking about the spanning set, these four can span these five. These five column vectors can span column space of A. These five column vectors can span column space of B, but not column space of A. But these five can span, but they are not linearly independent. So to find the linearly independent column vectors of A, we need to convert it into echelon form so that we can find the pivot columns. Same pivot columns, column numbers only we have to take from the echelon form. So those corresponding pivot columns of A are linearly independent. So those pivot columns of A alone can form the basis for column spacing. So this is about column spacing. Now let us move on to null space A. So for to find the basis for null space A or vectors in null space A, we need reduced echelon form, which is more convenient to find out those vectors. So now our B is further reduced into reduced echelon form by performing elementary row operations. So now this is in reduced echelon form. The difference between echelon form and reduced echelon form is where this is a leading entry, there will not be any non-zero entry other than this. So we have a non-zero entry here. So I need to make it zero by using this one. Similarly, this leading entry, this pivot position must be one in reduced echelon form, and these two must be zeros in reduced echelon form. So to convert this into reduced echelon form, I need to make it zero. I need to make this three zero, and these two are zeros by using this one. Before that, I will make it one. All leading entries are one, and the remaining entries are zeros in reduced echelon form. So the reduced echelon form of B is this one. The equation AX is equal to O is equivalent to CX is equal to O, the null matrix, since A is row equivalent to C. So if I convert this relation, this matrix, into equations, I will get this x1. This is related to x1. X2 is option. So x1 plus x3 plus x5 is equal to 0. So I have to perform an argument matrix CO, then that all the entries in the last column will be zeros. By converting that into equations, we get x1 plus x3 plus x5 is equal to 0, and this is x2 minus 2x3 plus 3x5 is equal to 0, and x4 minus 5x5 is equal to 0. So these three are the corresponding vectors. So these three can be further simplified as x1 is equal to minus x3 minus x5, x2 is equal to minus, comes here, so it is 2x3 minus 3x5, and x4 is equal to 5x5. These three are the relations between x1 and x2 and x3, x4, x5. So we have five variables here, so the values are related by these equations. So we can observe that in these equations, x3 and x5 are free variables. So the vector x1, x2, x3, x4, x5 can be written in this form. The relations between these five components, five unknowns, are written here. X1 is minus x3 minus x5, and x2 is 2x3 minus 3x5, x3 is x3, x4 is related to x5 with 5x5, so it is written as 5x5, and x5 is a free variable, x5, so it is x5. So since we have two free variables in this, so this can be written in this form, x3 is taken common, so minus 1, 2, 1, 0, 0, plus x5 times, minus 1, minus 3, 0, 5, and this is 1 time. So if I take this one as V1 and this one as V2, now it is in the form of X3 V1 plus X5 V2. So it is a linear combination of these two vectors. So the basis of null space A contains these two vectors. These two vectors. So this is the basis of null space A. Here you can observe that the dimension of null space A is 2, since there are only two vectors in this one, and the dimension of column space A is 3, since there are three vectors, and these vectors belongs to R4. Here we have taken the matrix M by N, so here M is 4. So I can say that column space A belongs to Rm, that is R4 here, and null space A, here we have 5 components in each vector, so these belongs to Rn, that is 5 R5, n is 5 here. So here also we have 3 vectors, so dimension of row space A is equal to 3. So from this example you can observe that the dimension of row space A is equal to dimension of null space A. Dimension of column space A. Dimension of row space A is equal to dimension of column space A. And row space A and column space A, row space A and null space A are subspaces of Rn. Whereas column space A is a subspace of Rm. So the dimension of row space A and column space A are same. Whereas the dimension of null space A is different from these two. And we can also observe that this is 3 and that is 2. If we add these two, we will get n, that is number of columns in the given matrix. So that will be our next rank theorem. Before that, let us define rank of a matrix first. So the rank of A. Here we simply define the rank of A as the dimension of column space A. We already know what is the dimension of column space A. That is the number of vectors in the basis of column space A. Column space A is nothing but the linear combination of all columns of matrix A. So we need to form a basis for column space A, and the number of vectors in the basis of column space A is the rank of A, and it is denoted by rank A. This is the symbol. This is the notation for the rank A, rank of A. So simply we can say that rank of A is equal to dimension of column space A. So since row space of A is same as column space A transpose, since if we transpose the matrix, the rows will become columns. Rows of A will become columns of A transpose. So dimension of the row space A is the dimension of column space A transpose, that is the rank of A transpose. So dimension of row space A is equal to rank of A transpose. So this is the definition of rank of A. So from the previous example we can say that rank of that matrix is 3. Since there are 3 vectors in the basis of column space A. So the dimension of column space A is 3 there. So we can say that rank of A is 3 for that matrix. Sometimes we call the null space of A by nullity of A. So nullity of A is nothing but null space of A, which gives solutions for the homogeneous equation Ax is equal to O. So let us prove this rank theorem, which has significant results, which we discuss later on. So let us first go through the statement of the theorem. The dimension of the column space and the row space of an m by n matrix are equal. Earlier in the definition, we have shown that the dimension of row space A is equal to dimension of column space A transpose. Now we are going to prove that the dimension of row space A and dimension of column space A both are same. This common dimension, the rank of A, also equals the number of pivot positions in A and satisfies the equation. Rank A plus dimension of A is equal to n. So after this theorem, we can say that rank of A is nothing but number of pivot columns of a matrix, and that number is equal to the dimension of row space A and column space of row space. So it is very simple to find the rank of a matrix and the dimension of row space A and the dimension of column space A by simply converting the matrix into echelon form and count the pivot columns. That number will be the rank of A and the dimension of row space A and dimension of column space A. And as per our previous result, we can also say that that is the dimension of column space A transpose. So it is the dimension of row space A transpose also, and that will be the rank of A transpose also. So all these will be a single number, that is number of pivot columns in matrix A, and the only different thing is dimension of null space A, which can be obtained by this relation. Rank A is equal to dimension of null A. Rank A plus dimension of null A is equal to n. So we can say the dimension of null A is equal to n minus rank of A. So if you can find the number of pivot columns, you can find the rank of A, and you can find the dimension of null A also by using this formula. So let us do this. You know, let us take an m by n matrix with r pivots. Assume that A has r pivots. Then obviously A has r pivot columns. We know that pivots are nothing but the leading entries in which there will be a non-zero entry and all the entries below it must be zeros. Then A has r pivot columns, and since A has n columns, out of which R are pivot. Remaining columns are n minus r. So the n minus r columns are non-pivot columns. So I have taken a matrix A of order m by n, which means that A has m rows and n columns. I have already assumed that, also assumed that A has r pivots. So now A has r pivot columns and n minus r non-pivot columns. Clearly, r is less than or equal to n. Since I have to select the pivot columns from the columns of A only, so I can't go beyond A. So I have to choose the pivot columns from the columns of A only. So obviously, r is less than or equal to n. Maybe all the columns may be pivot. So in that case, r will be equal to n. Otherwise, r is less than n. So in both the cases, I can say that r is less than or equal to n. We know that the pivot columns of A form a basis for column space A. So pivot columns of A are linearly independent and they can span entire set of column space A. So the pivot columns of A form a basis for column space A. So now I can say that since that basis has r pivots, dimension of column space A is r. Since there are r vectors in the basis of column space A, so dimension of column space A is equal to r. So from our definition, rank of A is nothing but dimension of column space A. So the rank of A is r. It is also r. Since A is row equivalent to B, which is in echelon form, the number of pivot columns in A is equal to the number of pivot columns in B. So when you are converting the matrix A into some echelon form, then that matrix will have pivots and each row of B, which is row equivalent to A, will contain only one pivot. No row can contain two pivots. So B has a non-zero row for each pivot column. And non-zero rows of B form a basis for row space B as well as row space A. Since there are r pivots, in the equivalent form of A, row equivalent form of A, which is B, in that B also there will be r pivots. And each pivot will be arranged in a different row. Since no row can contain two pivots in a single row, so there must be r rows in which there is a pivot. So if there is a pivot, that must be a non-zero row. Since in the pivot position you can't put a zero, that must be a non-zero. So the row must be non-zero. So there are non-zero rows. Since it is in echelon form, remaining rows will become zero rows. So these are non-zero rows, form a basis for row space B. And we have seen in the earlier example that the non-zero rows of B can form the basis of A also, can form the basis of row space of A also. So the non-zero rows of B, which is echelon form of A, contains R non-zero rows, and these R non-zero rows can form the basis of A. Since there are R vectors in the basis, the dimension of B is equal to, the dimension of row space B is equal to dimension of row space A, that is equal to R. Since there are R vectors, that is also equal to the rank of A, since rank A is also R. So we can now say that the dimension of column space A and dimension of null, dimension of row space A and rank of A are all equal. Now let us come to dimension of null space. The dimension of null space A equals the number of free variables in the equation Ax is equal to 1. These free variables comes from the non-pivot elements. Therefore, the dimension of null space A is equal to number of columns in of A that are not pivot, non-pivot columns. Number of columns of A that are non-pivot columns. So we have already seen that there are n minus r non-pivot columns. So dimension of null space A is n minus r. In the earlier example also we have seen that it is a 4 by 5 matrix in which there are two free variables x3 and x5. That is why there are two vectors in the null space of A. So the dimension of null A is 2 there. Similarly, as the number of free variables is equal to the number of non-pivot columns, and these free variables, the multiples of these free variables will form the basis for null space A. So the dimension of null space A is equal to n minus r. So if we add these two, r plus n minus r, we will get n. So rank A, which is representing r here, and n minus r is represented by dimension of null A. So rank A plus dimension of null space A is equal to r plus n minus r, that is equal to n. So this is the proof of the statement. Using this statement, if you know the pivot columns of a matrix, you can find rank of A, dimension of column space A, dimension of row space A. Since dimension of row space A is equal to dimension of column space A transpose, you can also find the dimension of column space A transpose, which is equivalent to rank of A transpose. So rank of A transpose is also that number that is equal to dimension of row space of A transpose. So all these are all equal to number of pivot columns of A. And from this final statement, rank A plus dimension of null space A is equal to n, we can also get the dimension of null space A. by simply subtracting rank A from M. So let us look into a simple example on this concept. If A is 7x9 matrix with 2-dimensional null space, what is the rank of A? So since A is 7x9 matrix, A has 7 rows and 9 columns. Here M is 7 and N is 9. It has 9 columns. So N is 9. We know from the rank theorem that rank A plus dimension of null A is N. So, and it is given that dimension of null space A is 2. Is also given in the hypothesis. So if you substitute these two here and N is 9, rank A is 9 minus 2, that is 7. So similarly, this is one more problem. Could a 6x9 matrix have a 2-dimensional null space? Since it is 6x9 matrix, it has 6 rows and 9 columns. Again, N is 9 here. And we know the rank theorem statement, rank A plus dimension of null A is 2. Here in the hypothesis, it is given that is it possible to have a 2-dimensional null space? Let us assume that dimension of null space is 2. Then you will get rank of A is 7. So 9 minus 2 is 7. But rank A is equal to 7 will give you that the matrix has 7 pivot columns, but there are only 6 rows. A has only 6 rows, and from this it should have 7 pivots, which is not at all possible. So this is a contradiction. From 6 rows, 7 pivots means at least one of the row of A contain 2 pivots, which is not possible. So it is not a problem. A 2-dimensional null space is not possible for a matrix 6x9. With this, I am concluding the today's class. Thank you for watching.